the Lord Jesus said, people persecuted me, they will persecute you, because you are my disciples. Everybody who is a true disciple will have to suffer some persecution. We believe in the teaching of the Lord and the teachings of the apostles. And Paul said in his epistle to the Corinthians, you have to separate.
I think it still means something to them over there. Whereas over here, it would be impossible to do anything of the kind. You know? And how important that is, it would be very difficult to say, I guess. I never really felt the strong separation that people might think of when they think of Mennonites. In fact, I never really felt that I was separate from the rest of society anyway.
I find that the rhythm of my being seems to move in rhythm with many things around me. I lie down on my floor in the living room and listen to Janis Joplin. And I can listen to that thing three or four times in a row. You know, my children come in, they're surprised to see their old man, you know, lying on the living room floor listening to Janis Joplin. And I'm trying to figure out myself, I don't really know, why is it?
It's a good question. It's a pretty existential thing, you know. I mean, it changes. I think a Mennonite was able to do 25 years ago, as contrasted to what he could do today, has really changed a lot. Certainly the isolationist idea, that is, I lose myself in the group and I don't get out there, is a poor defense, and it's breaking down at every hand in our time anyway. I think we need to learn to go our own way, but I think we need to learn, really, to get on in this world of ours without becoming tainted by it. And that's really what great art is all about, isn't it? I mean, that's what a fugue ultimately is all about. Using, if you will, the techniques that the composer had at his disposal and making something of it which is really quite otherworldly.
This in the world and not of the world concept is a favorite of Mennonites historically. When I was in Switzerland, I found people driven up in the mountains and defending why they were there historically, that they wanted to be in the world but not of it, whereas the younger theologians were saying, but this is not what it means, that one in fact must be in the world geographically, and being in the world, not sell out to the world in which one is.
Let us bow for prayer.
But I think there is a conflict on the idea of utopianism,
Lord God, the Holy Ghost,
versus scattering
hour,
into the world.
As on the day of Pentecost,
and there are many Mennonites who say that
we
if you want to be Christian, it means that you wear this kind of dress, this kind of head
Lord,
covering, you wear a beard, and whatever else is entailed
like
with their particular outward
the beneath,
expression of this lifestyle,
impulse, every mind,
which symbolically
soul,
indicates how they feel about the city.
Young, the old inspired,
and yet on the other hand, there are those who
and give us
preach
hearts and tongues
about
of fire,
breaking up the ghettos, as some of them would refer
Spirit
to the smaller
light,
villages and the towns,
and chase our gloom away,
saying that one should not
more
pile
more
salt. The salt was meant
day
to be dispersed.
So you can't somehow say that we are islands of holiness. Once upon a time, we were, people prided themselves on being the stillen land, the quiet in the land. So you lived your life more or less the way the Amish still do. This is your Christianity spelled out in everyday affairs of life, the way you set up your farm, the way you train your children, the way you do your work, and live peaceably with all men. And I think there's a good element in that, that it takes 30 years to live out a certain way of life that has meaning. And I respect that kind of view, even though I think I see shortcomings in it as well. It's just that we no longer live like that, you see.
We live in a society which is geared to making money, to preserving an American or Canadian way of life, without ever really examining the specifics of these. There are obviously many good things about an apple pie existence, but is it the only thing that I want to do? Are there more important things? You see, we've been basically an agriculturally oriented people until about oh, 30, 40 years ago, when the Mennonites began to move into the city, as did everyone else in this country. And one of the things that I see happening in the Mennonite group is a growing materialism. I like to think that I'm not a materialist. I hope I'm not. I'm afraid I am all too often materialistic in my choices.
We just bought ourselves a new house. We bought a house with a lot of waste space in it. And it's not functional. It's got a very grand staircase and so on. It uses up a lot of room. I think it's partly that I've grown up in a society where things were very functional. And I'm reacting against that.
We've become terribly enamored of our things, of our homes and our cars and skidoos and boats and colored televisions. And I think with it, we've lost a certain value that we used to have. We're now a part of the city, and we are faced with problems and pressures that we haven't had until a generation ago.
You know, I find myself under considerable pressure from the fashions around me. I'm attracted to them. And I must say I have a guilty conscience very often when I start adopting them by buying a cottage, for instance, at the lake. I don't know whether I did it because a lot of my friends were doing it. It's the kind of thing they do.
And again, this is the problem because we have wealthy business people, people involved in various professions, who, however, do not get into the public eye the way an artist does, for instance. And they may indulge, if I may use that term, in a lot of things that they themselves would frown on if they saw so-and-so doing this, you see.
I have a Mennonite friend who bought himself a big boat. He's a nouveau rich. And he went to his neighbor and he said, "Look at my nice big motorboat." And his neighbor said to him, "John, you can't be happy with a boat like that. It's far too small." And John took him seriously, and next week called up his neighbor and said, "Now, what do you think of that?" And he bought himself a big yacht. And this is the kind of thing that I'm trying to desperately to avoid falling into.
It's a kind of a double standard that Mennonites have. When I was a boy, to be a lawyer, for instance, was already entering into the affairs of the state far too much, you see. Well, now we have numerous lawyers coming out of the Mennonite ranks. We have Mennonite politicians. It's the in thing to do now, to be elected to the assembly.
This is where I caused my parents no end of grief, by changing careers several times in my life. One tends to become a dilettante. This is the big temptation, I think. I must make amends. Worked hard. I was moved a couple of years ago when I read Soren Kierkegaard's Purity of Heart is to Will One Thing. And that, to me, it says in modern language maybe what the Mennonites were trying to say with the simple life, that you concentrate on a few things in life and do them well. That's it.
But what you've got now is something totally different. Our people are in all the professions, you might say. They're scattered around the cities. We don't live next to each other. We don't feel geographically or physically united, so that you're bound to become a different kind of person. And then you begin to relate to your faith, your way of life. And you begin to see the faith can be expressed in so many different ways.
You gravitate into a religious persuasion often as one gravitates into a political party. I was raised in the atmosphere of the Mennonite faith and therefore gravitated to this value system. There were, of course, times, particularly through the years of college in graduate studies, where I had some hang-ups, some problems, some questions about why I persisted in the faith. Some of them had to do with ideals versus the abuses of these ideals. And at this point, of course, my own background became a part of a larger spectrum. I think I was a stronger person in my faith than I had been before.
How many of you have
other colleagues did not feel as strongly after coming out? But the other side of the coin is that these young men leave their homes and for the first time have an encounter with the world. And for some of these young men, in fact, I think for most of them, this is a kind of tourist's exposure without father and mother around, without the dominant authoritarian church leaders around, and their first experience with different kinds of lifestyles. In fact, the first experience relating to other people. throughout their experiences at home, though they relate to the grocery man, the lumber man, it's always at arm's length. It's always with some concern that the value systems, the things that attract the other person, might begin to attract him or her as well. I guess the most difficult thing for the young fellows to sort out is that they meet good people, some very fine people outside of their own ranks. And this is very, very disillusioning to them.
In the Bible, we read of people getting those kinds of ideas. A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, "Give me the portion of your goods which will someday be mine." And the father divided his property between them. And not many days after, the younger son took all that he had and journeyed into a far country.
I grew up in the city, and I feel I had a very normal upbringing, which I think would be quite different to some of the Mennonite kids who grew up in some very small town and perhaps would have a completely different conception of life. For instance, those of us who live in the city perhaps may appear very worldly just by the way we look or something to people who would come here, say, from a very small place and may feel, well, these people certainly must live a very indulgent life, you know.
We used to, I think, be able to meet somebody in a city and you'd say, now he must be Mennonite because he had a certain look, you see, but even that has changed. You can't be sure anymore. So there are no outward signs. You go down the street, you couldn't say, now that's a Mennonite house because of the way it's built or looked at. You couldn't do that anymore.
And yet, even we city people, a lot of us have deprived ourselves of things like the movies and so forth. And I don't think we should be apologetic about it. There are certain things that we rather feel we would not do. Certain things you'll go along with and certain things you will not.
For example, our parents used to make quite a lot of the fact that you must shun all evil and just the minded allen boos and shine is the German expression. You avoid even just the appearance of evil, I guess that's the translation. So we were discouraged from reading jokes and the funny papers because this kind of thing was somehow light stuff. There was stuff mixed in there that wouldn't be good for us, you see. We were even discouraged to go into cafes and like because the jukeboxes and the smoke and the gentle flavor wouldn't be a good influence.
I think that, you know, I feel I'm a part of a community called Mennonite, and I don't feel any strong nostalgic attachment to it. I could very easily move tomorrow, I think, to a city like Hamburg, which I lived in for 1 year, and stay the rest of my life and not, I think, really miss home. We didn't miss it when I was there for a year. But I feel there's a strong community element in the Christian faith as well. I think the fact that Jesus gathered 12 people around him and gathered also some women around him seemed to help him a great deal.
Of course, as a child,
this is true. And one of the things that I like most about the so-called Anabaptist
movies.
Tradition is that you work out your destiny
we
and fellowship
cards.
Of other people.
But we were able to take music lessons, we traveled, and to tell you the truth, I just don't
think
the
other day we
missed
had
a great deal.
Party at our cottage.
That I'm any
very
the poorer for not
that
having been able to do these things. For instance,
and we had a tremendous time. We finished a big jug of wine together, and we ended
most
up,
of my neighbors feel
you know, really,
ought to drive 90 miles to the lake,
games
you know,
lawn,
to have fun.
Which we would probably not do if we hadn't been drinking.
I think I'm having
and yet,
much more
at a certain point, we decided to stop drinking because they knew they were driving home later on. And so we had coffee at 6, and they waited until about 10
or
11 so that
frequently
they could
put emphasis too much on
and I felt even there, there was a certain element of restraint came in, which I don't think I would find in some other groups of people. I find I'm usually one of the first to leave a party if there happen to be a lot of non-Mennonites present. My wife and I have parties for non-Mennonites. They usually last till 3 or 4, and we usually have to plan for about twice as much rye as if we have Mennonite. Most of our Mennonite friends drink. This is one element, you know, where it comes in. I know I have to buy 2 or 3 bottles of rye if I have 10 Mennonite friends coming. I've got to buy about 6, 7 bottles if I have non-Mennonite friends coming.
On
so even though they drink,
I
there seems to be an element of moderation.
Some people
which I
need
think
these kind
help.
Of crutches. Of course, I love people, and I love just watching people, observing people.
And yet,
my
I
father would be horrified if
like
he knew I had gone to these particular places.
I find
but they always interest
speaking,
me.
I like the new fashions.
In spite of the fact that
I
don't participate in things going on.
My wife
I think that today,
I don't like her in
worshiping originality for its own
fashion.
Sake, I don't think you have to experience everything in order to come to some kind of a value judgment. It's not because I'm a Mennonite that I think that way.
long dress.
It's just simply the way I'm constituted.
My brother's girlfriend
I just
told me
don't
to buy a shirt. She said my
believe
shirt's
in change for change's sake. I think style changes
and
are
I enjoyed very much walking
to
dress
idiotic
shop with her and picking out a
clothes,
shirt that
for
was a
example.
Flouncy.
I think we have
I
to
feel
keep
good
an open
it,
mind
you know,
and
I like looks
where
it. I'm sure
we find something that is of value that is traditional.
The ads are on
it's only sensible.
I don't have any conscious desire to try to counter them. Again, I'm not trying to be too introspective, but I find that when it comes to dancing, for example, I prefer rock
and I don't think
to
we have to get
music
ourselves
I think it's partly that
muddy,
the last couple of years
just
of
to find out
really
the mud is mud. You can see that
to,
without getting
my emotions
yourself
go a bit.
However,
and
I
feel this music allows me to do
try
that.
To understand
it's opening
people
up a life which I suppose I was
everybody's
a afraid
different
of. I don't
it's
think I'm overly impressed with it, and yet I like its exhilarating
illustration,
effect.
I don't know, but I have a prayer that I say every morning before I go to work. God, help me this day to be kind to the people who annoy me most.
But this was largely an a priori judgment. They just suspected this would be the case. It's like philosophy that'll lead you astray at university, you see. The philosophy classes are the dangerous ones because they will give you a different view of life and a different framework in which you see your whole life and your existence and the meaning of man, and all of this is sort of atheistic and man-made humanism, in other words. That's the dangerous thing. Well, I think the church has lost that round. That kind of view has certainly disappeared.
This is changing, and I would think for the better. The view that our parents had, that we are in the world and yet not of the world, this is changing. We are becoming more involved, but I would think that Mennonites will always remain somewhat separate, that they will never really completely be able to identify with any of the countries or places that they will be living in. They will adapt to a certain degree, and of course, if they're going to live in Spain, they'll speak Spanish, I'll grant you that. You adapt yourself to the situation that you're living in and still remember whose child you are.
O God, our Father, we thank you for the story of the father of the prodigal son. We thank you for this message.
I'm aware of the fact that Mennonites can and have
you know
gone
us,
off
you know what kind
on
of
one end or the other.
Are.
For example, the Amish
are
very persistent in their
so
intent to remain in rural settings.
Feel that you cannot accept
a small
us
group that is often nicknamed the Holdeman people,
we thank you for this
although
message
their official name is the Church of God
pray
in Christ Mennonite,
to their very
typify,
depths of our souls today,
I think, perhaps the most interesting of the Mennonite groups in their concern to be both evangelical, conversion-minded, missionary-directed, and yet to
and
be as well an isolated people. They have obviously a great deal of difficulty in being both mission-interested and remaining rural, because they talk most
concerns
frequently about being
the
in the world but not of the world. And yet I approach them with the statement, but the world that God loves is the world of people. How do you intend to relate
Father,
to people if you're not where people are?
Reflect
my reason for bringing this up as a case in point is because I think that this typifies in part really the history of all Mennonites, perhaps the history of many people who come from an isolated pietistic background. The breakdown of the historic ethnic Mennonite kind of existence in view of their relatively recent concern for being in the world in order to evangelize is also at the same time the road that will lead them away from that which they have been,
it may change the circumstances,
and in many cases that which they
function
have called cardinal to their own existence.
We may be the leaven which you have called us to redeem the world.
I recall 15 years ago, the question of television, for instance, was raised in our churches, and I think it was a good question. Should we
allow our members to have television in their homes in view of the fact that 95% of the programs on television are not worth watching and may indeed be harmful. It was agreed at that time that our members would not have television sets in their homes. But of course, after another 5 years, when it was uncommon for a reasonably affluent family not to have a television set, and the Mennonites began to buy them as well. And for a period of about 5 or 6 years, there was a kind of deliberate winking at this. As if you simply didn't pay any attention to it. It was happening. You could sense that the hierarchy wished it weren't, but it was. It was inevitable. I wish that the group would think through some things. And if 10 years ago it was not good for me to have a television set, why is it possibly okay now?
It's related to the whole attitude of the Mennonites to the arts, which is a complete chapter in itself. For example, I can't imagine any congregation today hearing a 12-tone church anthem and then somehow suggesting that this could glorify God too. That is unreal.
Matter of fact, I had a rather prominent gentleman in the Mennonite church ask me how I accommodated this obvious conflict that arises between the dissonance of William Walton's Belshazzar's Feast and the harmony of the Christian experience, you see. Now, of course, I wasn't prepared to admit that Walton's music is dissonant. I mean, this is something that Walton himself would have to say. Is it dissonant, is it not? It's a terribly relative thing. But there's a reaction in some quarters now to music making, which has reached, shall we say, a more sophisticated level than other artistic endeavors in the group.
Even my own work, I feel that I'm only 50% involved. The church doesn't know what to do with the other 50% that I have, let's say, that I'm excited about. You don't know what to do with my 12-tone interests, let's say. They have no use for them. How shall you use them when nobody wants to hear that kind of music? You know, it's very frustrating.
Communication, of course, is the big problem. If people don't understand it, it therefore is no good. How could you want to write a string quartet, an atonal string quartet, if people wouldn't understand it, if they don't appreciate it, if it doesn't sell? I have friends in the business world who say, you know, the lumber business. And if my product doesn't sell, it's no good. If people don't like a Schütz motet, forget it. Don't sing it, you see. It's no good. Sing gospel songs. Fail to remember the fact that gospel songs, of course, were written for a very, very small period in history. They were written for a particular time. They're probably one of the first examples of disposable music. A pop culture that has been fossilized and is still used too much in our churches.
It's very, very difficult for one person, even the church pastor, to try to tell you, now this kind of literature you can read, but this other is dangerous. This has been very irksome to many of us in the past, because you set up a kind of schizophrenia after a while. The person who feels justified in going to see a certain film, just as he might read a modern novel or go to see a modern play. If my faith is mature, then surely I'm not going to swallow everything that comes there. I mean, that's what I've got a mind for, that I learned to discriminate between the spirits. You can learn all about the atomic bomb without wanting to blow anybody to bits with it, you see. Waiting for Godot, for example, is a very powerful existentialist drama, I would say. It was moving very deeply the few times that I've seen it, and I'd be glad to see it again. Which has at its base, you might say, the entire existentialist philosophy. In a sense, it becomes a kind of indictment of the church, because the characters in the drama pretty well project that they're waiting for Godot, or waiting for Godot, some people say, which I guess is waiting for God to come into their lives and give them meaning.
Selma were serving our last big show. Now inside we have 30 outstanding young ladies, professional models, chorus girls, striptease dancers, just about every type of entertainment that you could look for in a burlesque show. This young lady that you see pictured over here is only 26 inches tall, and she is also one of our striptease dancers.
If the Christians are God's representatives here, then we, who call ourselves Christians, have not somehow communicated the meaning that we say God gives to our lives to these people are looking for. And so they live in an absurd existence. Life makes no sense. One day is like the other, and they wait for meaning to come into their lives, and they're disappointed right to the end. I found it a tremendously moving and very challenging presentation of man's lostness as he feels it today, and this mood is widespread. But I'm well aware that there are many people in our Mennonite fold who simply don't live in that kind of world, and they don't see the need to go and see plays like that.
There are people who do, but they are on the fringe of the Mennonite group. I think the Mennonites are very brotherhood conscious, as you know, and tend to be somewhat suspicious of any individual who becomes a specialist, if I may use that term, who goes somewhat farther in any given discipline than the average layman. And the whole idea of wanting to do something with the choir that these individual singers will not be able to take back to their churches and use was utterly inconceivable to a lot of people. The idea of art being there, and if I don't appreciate it, maybe my grandchildren will. You find no sympathy for that kind of thing.
I think many of them feel that it's a projection of the artist as a person, that somehow he is putting himself into the focal point. There's no way of getting around it. If you sing a solo, you're projecting yourself, and then somehow the message of the gospel will come off second best. And yet the more I became familiar with the Bible, the less impressive I found that point of view. When I read the scriptures, the psalms, the way the tabernacle was made in days of old, David making musical instruments and lining up the Levites in a kind of conservatory music with 288 instructors, you get the impression there that this was all they did. They were full-time musicians, and they were trained to do this. You're to play skillfully to the Lord with loud shouts. If you can't do that, well, make a joyful noise. Even that's delightful to God. And I don't get the impression at all from the Bible that God is afraid of the fine arts. You see, not nearly as much as we were. If I listen to a Beethoven symphony, I get more out of it even than just chords, progressions, and notes. There's a deeper quality to it. It is part of the human spirit. It's a good thing in itself, even if Beethoven didn't write it to the glory of God, let's say the way Bach might write his fugues and all the rest. And I'm not trying to say that it's the same kind of thing that you get in the scriptures, but I would say it's the kind of thing that you get from a mountain, from a tree, from a star. This is part of God's world. It is the abundant life that is there if you enter into it. That a mountain is there for the glory of God. Everything that he has made praises him. But if you don't look at it with that kind of eye, you won't see God's glory there. You'll see a heap of stones or something, and nothing much more necessarily. You may be impressed by it, but you will not relate it to anything beyond that. In other words, your worldview doesn't take into account a certain creator.
As indicated, next Sunday we will be celebrating the Lord's Supper here. It's customary before we celebrate communion to reflect a bit. I'd like to do that on the basis of Luke chapter 22, verse 15, where we find the words, "How I have longed to eat this Passover with you." As we know, these are words of Jesus. And I want not so much to do an exegesis of the passage today, but simply to use it as background for some thoughts which I would like to share with you. Just a few comments about the context. Jesus lived in a time of conflict.
It appears to me,
it seems to me that there was an inevitableness
of Jesus
that in that context
to the earth and being among people,
one such as Jesus taking the position that he did
of what the in the world but not of the world
was
concept
bound to
is.
End in death.
It is not simply
his
know,
kind
the
of commitment
to heaven kind of thing.
Was intolerable in the face of the desperate situation
to see
in which
that
he lived.
To be a Christ follower means to
he came into a world which was talking peace
total well-being
but making
of
war.
The next person.
And he came into that situation with
initially,
his radical emphasis
that the idea of
on
a regulated life
people.
Grew out of a body of believers gathering together,
in that context,
covenanting
Jesus
with each other that this
no
is what
way.
They would do for a given period of time.
And in the intensity of that situation,
back again
we find
and
again and again
an atmosphere
that
of prayer
Jesus
and sensitivity
withdraws.
To each other. And an understanding
either
of the
alone
world in which
or
they
with
live,
his disciples
would then again determine what the covenant would
for
be
prayer
for
and
the
meditation.
Year that would follow.
I always think
the abuses that came about in this system
church,
were that
I
they took shortcuts.
Democratic meetings
and
that
the teenage kids that arose in the ranks ultimately
told his face that he's
and
wrong.
And it is one which truly
with the stamp of approval that came on last year's
and
covenant.
The bishop and I had
that
disagreement.
The man
with the emotion against the bishop and the
teenage
kids getting really very heated arguments
are different in the world from those
in the course of the debate. But I think it's very healthy.
Behold, we are not
new
dictated from a hierarchy.
Among the young
and I think this makes for probably
law,
a great divergence
a
of opinion among
it.
Mennonites.
Not desirable.
I think by and large,
it
Mennonites
be.
Believe
it
that God
before.
Has given man free
but
will.
But it is now, and we feel
and that everyone can interpret scripture for
among the
life.
Young.
In their own way.
I think the pressure nowadays is making things more difficult for the children than it did
scripture
when we were
change.
Youngsters.
But
our whole
understanding
world
of
has changed so dramatically.
Needs enlightenment
no matter how
and
you bring children up nowadays when they
no
get out into the world,
dare
the
we
standards
say,
or lack of standards
we've got absolutely all
are really
the light there is.
Very difficult for
we
young people.
Constantly
well,
have to humble ourselves.
Not to
and
just
say that maybe
taken over by all the bluff
still
and plain words that's around, but
more enlightenment.
Pick and choose.
You know,
and don't be apologetic for what you have and what you are.
Hierarchical system.
We call ourselves a
no outside body which can tell us
country.
In a local congregation this is what
then
you have to believe.
We can't understand.
We get together
can
every 3 years to decide on actions that we
people.
Want to take. And we
possible,
admonish each other.
Is.
But I think essentially we're quite free
we
within our local congregation to decide what we are going to do and what we are going to believe.
As much
I still
as
think, however, that
separate.
Some things that we carry with us are views, so some elements
where
of the Puritan
there has been an overly
that
narrow
time is
home
an important
situation.
Thing. If you go to
the
a party, you don't
there.
Have to stay
and
up
perhaps
before
this is where we have to be
you know,
careful.
When it's good.
If there's
and
joy in
living children,
and joy in
dance,
Christianity
the
for the years that we have,
but I think I would tell
the
them,
young
look,
people
the
are going to realize that there is something
to
this, that it isn't just some old lost custom.
If you have things to do next morning, by all means,
we have something that we should treasure and keep.
I had a father who was a minister in the Mennonite church
overboard for everything
who was
else that is coming
staunch
our way. Of course, there's rebellion even where there has been very loose
a very strict
home
father.
Life. You just see rebellion, period. I think people rebel
family.
Just for the
we
sake
weren't
of rebelling.
Very
nowadays.
Happy with
if
some
they
of the
bang that drum
that
and give you all the rock
to.
Sock in your ears,
today,
well, that's one way of doing it.
We feel that
money.
When we're with Father,
they are under the control
some of
the
things
church,
that we believe.
They are responsible.
And that have changed
the
in our way of life.
Them responsible and
we just don't talk
we have
about
to answer this question. Are you willing
we
to follow
is hurt him.
These
but
rules
there are certain things
which we
I feel are very important.
Read to you.
Things
you
like conscientious objection is very
yes
important to me.
So they are responsible
you know, I think this
to the
began
church
during the war
for their life.
And tell us about the Allied side in the Second World War. And this differed very radically from the interpretation of the war that I had from home.
Mind you, I feel I'm as confused today about Mennonites in a sense.
But the thing is, a very definite separation began to enter at that point. And we started to believe our teachers and school inspectors more than our parents. Remember a confrontation with an inspector who fought in the Boer War. And he talked about the glories of the British campaign in the Boer War. I got up and I said, I was quite naive, I think. I didn't really think I was hurting him or embarrassing him. I just said, my father gave me quite a different interpretation of the Boer War at home. And he said, son, there is only one side, and that's the British side.
Look, children, you're going to have to learn to pray both in German and in English, which was a new experience for us. And we felt these Mennonites had come from another country where
somehow they could keep that from us.
Different than we were.
Our parents tended to stress that somehow we had a kind of German heritage. Many
but
of us are
what I'm trying to say is this mixed background that we have. We're really
and
German, we're
they
Dutch,
used to feel
we're Russian,
that if the language
we're all kinds of things.
I think it shows that many of our people basically are not
Canadians,
very strong.
A little bit of all of this
you know, they look upon it as, I guess as most Christians do, as an idea that one wish could be realized in this world, but probably cannot.
What have you.
So you must choose sides. This is partly the experience they had in Russia, where they
the idea of
found themselves being decimated in some villages by anarchist bands against which there seemed to be no control. And so they even formed their own armies when they came to Canada. Many of them had lost this strong attachment to this idea. Also, when they came out of Russia in 1923-24, they were accepted by Germany at a time when no other country wanted to grant them the rights to move through to North America.
And that's
so they came to Canada with two very strong, you might say, political convictions. One was that Germany was a benevolent country. The other was that Mackenzie King and the Liberals could do no wrong. They voted Liberal without question, and they supported Germany without question.
Really matter,
and
see.
I think it shows that
the
nationalism
itself
and language
itself
was
itself
then
is not that important to me.
You know, religious ideals which they had.
I think that stretching our hand out to help those
take the attitude toward the war in Vietnam.
Mennonites are
sending young people abroad to work in Vietnam.
This is why Mennonite does not have the primary value.
I think it's no accident, for example, that right now.
The whole state has always been one major separation
in closer to somebody who is not
gradually
administration
of that service work has been done by the
feeling,
this
is happening,
and yet they remain basically skeptical.
In some groups, it's not true of all Mennonite groups at all.
Guys are thinking in many cases,
a choice.
Your mouth
where I feel
but
our avenue is open to many of them. Doctors are not doing it.
Instead, they're talking.
Unless it helps our fellow men.
For the simple reason that we see a lot of states around
us share our goods with our fellow
men.
But
is
I'm
very
disappointed
to me. I would be very anxious that the children would have some of these Anabaptist concepts.
I think that where we've started to debate the thing,
and this at the very time when other groups
came
we're raising
to
a lot
the
of
Anabaptist
coming
concept.
The other way. Now we have a lot of talks
of living out your Christian life to help your fellow man
as well as
and trying
we're
to
having
create
a good
peace.
Close look at the peace position of the
bringing
Anabaptist
about God's
tradition.
Kingdom.
And here, this group tends to be losing that viewpoint, and I think
this is something we Mennonites should think about. That all of us are becoming materialistic just because we've perhaps now come to owning some lovely homes, which most people in this world now do have.
And I'm sorry to see that happen.
Again, this is a gift.
We don't
need to get hung up on it.
Church.
To me, Christianity means unselfishness.
You know, you shall not
it's a switch from
and it tries to reconcile that with the condition of the world
the
by creating a hierarchy.
It
says we'll have certain people
it may not be quite a series,
who are not going to engage in these things
could be
in the war. Namely the priests
yes,
and so on. The average person must. You know, we've got to have some people who are, to some extent, out of this
Lord
world
Jesus
and some are in it. The majority will be in it, and they've got to fight the wars and so on.
Enemy
but we're always going to have an example before the people
need,
what the ideal should be like.
Feed him,
that, to me, is the reading of Catholic history in a way.
Give him
and I think it's
drink,
a very well thought and through and, to some extent, almost admirable
him.
Tradition, yet I
you know,
reject it.
Our parents
the other
have
tradition
undergone
is the Lutheran one, as I see,
difficult
where Luther
times. They've had to work so hard, and we've had it so good. Let's
faith
put it that way. We've been very fortunate and
no, there are no
sometimes
no
I think just like everyone else
diplomacy.
We must
you get a man like
ask
Bismarck,
ourselves
you know,
are we really able to cope
to
with
his
this are we handling it right or are we becoming
and
such stuffed shirts
and, being very
and affected
and yet,
so that before you know it
you
can't talk to
iron.
Certain people if
I reject that as well and I think in this way I accept the
beyond a certain degree
tradition here
well,
which I think says
I would
you
say
must try to bring your Christian convictions. Everybody
if I'm interested in the spiritual life of a person, I must first of all,
this
is
very important
to be in that person as a person.
That I treasure from my Mennonite background. You must take that text seriously. You don't try
who has
to
never trusted
circumvent
a human
the difficulties
being.
That it makes.
It would be absolutely futile for me to speak to this child.
No harm.
of God's love,
right.
For instance.
Well, then how can you go in the army and shoot somebody and say it doesn't do him any harm?
I don't want to.
This has become a popular thing now, you see. But 20 years ago, it's a very unpopular thing to say those kinds of things.
Oh, I think the concept of afterlife is the most exciting thing there is. I feel that I'm a stranger and a pilgrim here.
Now it's a very popular thing. Other people are shouting it from the housetops.
We have to make certain preparations if we intend to be welcome there and be part of it. I don't think we can sort of flip through this life and
self-conscious now
well
about
a
peace cause, because suddenly we see
that
our things have been taken away on us. I think that the all-embracing cause, of course, is brotherly love, as Christ taught. And traditionally, this is what Mennonites have tried to do. It can all be related to this if there's a genuine concern for your fellow man. The questions become academic, then, the question of causes, because there are simply obvious things to do. Whether it's a popular thing to do or not, it's not important, but I've always been taught from earliest childhood not to throw garbage on the streets. I mean, you don't throw papers on the street, because it's God's creation that you're spoiling if you do.
There are those who come back from the urban settings into their small villages and witness to their erstwhile friends, to their family, to their own congregations, that they have found life exciting and interesting and challenging in their new settings, and with great frequency entice and invite others into the larger urban settings. There are those who speak back to those who come in from the cities and say, well, I notice that you're not really retaining the faith. When I look at the lifestyle, the language of your son, your daughter, I think you've lost the faith, and you are not carrying out into that world that which you set out to carry at one time. And of course, the answer comes back, but this is not the important thing. The important thing is deeper than simply one's lifestyles or the retention of ethnic patterns. The dialogue has been going on virtually for decades, and there is an evolutionary pattern. There still is a common base. How long this common base will pull us together is, of course, I think, an open question. Some groups have seceded to the point where they have discontinued using the name Mennonite, which is rather typical of a trend which one begins to see.
This is the court of celebration of God's grace.
I'm not sure what the outcome will be. I could easily see that there could be a slow dissolution, because people aren't convinced that the Mennonite label is such, that it's just a label. And others again will say, well, really, it's what you make of it. The term has meaning insofar as you give it meaning, and I agree. I'm personally curious to see which way finally things will go, because they could go in several directions.
They're headed in about 50 different directions. There probably will be a major split with a right-wing group, that might be the wrong term for it, with the diehards sort of hanging on and trying to consolidate their position, retrenchment in terms of lifestyle, cutting back, possibly. And there is the other group, which is making itself increasingly felt, you know, the group which I think will become the cutting edge of Mennonitism in the years to come. Because they seem to have recaptured something of the true separation of early Anabaptism, that is, where you're not afraid really to buck the country, the philosophy extant in which you happen to find yourself.
We've been on the growing edge of this kind of thing for a long time in all kinds of ways, not just in, let's say, the whole process of higher education and what it might do to your faith and your church and all the rest. But everything else that comes with it, you know, arts and science and, well, that whole new world that opens up to you. And I think one of the basic problems we face is that we have a strong evangelical emphasis in our group. Because God so loved the world, we are to win others to the faith. Now, if the world is wicked, though, you shouldn't really mix with the world any more than you need to. Don't even go into a cafe if you can help it.
To celebrate God's divine pardon.
It's more worldly downtown Saturday night than it is to stay home. Well, you see, then you create problems. How shall you meet these people that are worldly and that you really shouldn't associate with too much, you see?
We tend to become.
And yet you have Christ associating with sinners, associating with characters that we are here to classify people. You know, they said he was too worldly.
To grade them.
And 2 weeks ago, I was at a church conference where this conflict stood out in sharp relief. You had the old guard, and you had a small group of young people who were interested enough in the affairs of the church to come to the annual convention, and they spoke their views. They were there with their long hair and their beards and their sandals.
I believe it lies within the fact that we find it so hard to take God's word seriously.
That this is where the important developments are going to come from.
It's very simple.
I see the other group as merging to a greater or lesser extent
as we gather for communion,
with
we
other
are called to
conservative,
identify
evangelical,
with one who loved his enemies
fundamentalist
so much
churches.
That he permitted himself
and these
to be nailed to the
other
cross.
Groups are much larger than any of the Mennonites are. And I think that the Mennonites in that group may well lose their identity.
It could slowly disintegrate. Our whole Mennonite unity could crumble. It's almost as if we seem to have a special genius for
but also to identify
building up differences and then allowing these perhaps to get a bit of a fanatical edge, the holier-than-thou kind of attitude, and you feel you're justified in splitting away from another group or a larger group.
The way of suffering and of
I think that can be understood perhaps historically, but even though our particular
Jesus,
denomination is called Mennonite Brethren, I have found it rather difficult to really be brotherly with other Mennonite bodies.
We
anyone who calls himself a Christian, from my point of view, is
to
my brother.
With his suffering.
So I think I represent quite a large body of opinion, certainly
live.
Amongst men or women my age, and
we
feel much the same
that
way.
Miracle,
I would like to be
then
in
we are challenged
setting
to further
where
identify
I am trusted,
and
thing,
accept the challenge
where my
of that way of
integrity
life.
As a person is not called into question.
Invitation to communion
so that when
come.
I do something, I can
I long
say
to celebrate
with assurance that
God's
this is me.
Mercy with you.
That I will not be accused of playing a game and that
it is an invitation
for fashionable reasons I'm doing this and I'm doing that and I'm doing the other thing. I want that very much. But I'm having trouble deciding what the peculiar Mennonite characteristics of my life are going to be. I'm not quite sure that they're going to be any other than the scriptural principles on which Mennonitism
we find it so difficult to accept the fact
to these
that
I adhere and I intend to. But increasingly, these are not going to be
as the psalmist says, our
Mennonite,
our sins are
because I find
before us.
People all over who are help becoming aware of the need for a genuine concern.
This
for
simple
people,
sentence,
who
your
are becoming
sins
aware
are
of the need to do something
grant
about
to us in this hour,
our time,
the joy
these things becoming
of fellowship with thee and with one another.
If the group is somehow able to come to grips with the problem
thank
of entering
you called
into society
us
as
to
it
new
is
life.
Today,
a new reality.
And trying to be a vital, constructive, positive
day,
force within that
society.
Each day, to
affirm ourselves again.
Then I'm very excited
as children of
about
Almighty
being a
Mennonite.
God. But if there let should be a reactionary trend, I would find that stifling, I'm afraid.
Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit go with us into our daily life. Amen.
You cannot build a kind of island of holiness in the middle of a city. I, for example, feel fairly strongly that I'm a citizen of the world in some sense. And you might say, just as God loved the world, I don't feel that I have any special need to relate more to a Mennonite view of the world than a Lutheran view of the world, or some other. In the early days when Paul traveled around to the church at Corinth, to the church at Ephesus, there was one church. You see, and this is an exciting thing, the fact that all Christians, all true believers, ought to form the body of Christ. This is an exciting thing, you see. I would like very much if one could get back to the spirit of Paul, where you might say, this is the church, the body of Christ, these are the believers.
I would like, yes, I would like my life really to to take place in the context of the Mennonites, because I feel very close to them. But depending on how things will develop in the next years, I and many others like me may well be crowded out of the active Mennonite scene. We may have to make our comments from the bleachers, so to speak. I think we'll continue to do that, but just to what extent we will be able to involve ourselves in Mennonite life is really quite a question.